suicide, smoking, and sticky cigarette, too. The central observation of those who study suicide is that in some place or under some circumstance, the act of one person taking his or her own life can be contagious. Suicide leads to suicide. The pioneer in this field is David Phillips, the sociologist at the University of California at San Diego, who has conducted a number of studies on suicide, each more fascinating and seemingly improbable than the last. He began by making a list of all the stories about suicide that ran on the front page of the country's most prominent newspapers in the 20 years stretch between the end of the 1940s and the end of the 1960s. Then he matched them up with suicide statistics from the same period. He wanted to know whether there was any relationship between the two. Sure enough, there was. Immediately after stories about suicide appeared, suicide in the area served by the newspaper jumped. In the case of national stories, the rate jumped nationally. Marianne Monroe's death was followed by the temporary 12% increase in the national suicide rate. Then Phillips repeated his experiment with a traffic accident. He took front page suicide stories from the Los Angeles Times and the San Francisco's Chronicle and matched them up with the traffic fatality from the state of California. He found the same pattern. On the day after a highly publicized suicide, the number of fatalities from traffic accident was on average 5.9% higher than expected. Today, after a suicide story, traffic deaths rose 4.1%. 3 days after, they rose 3.1%, and 4 days after, they rose 8.1%. After 10 days, the traffic fatality rate was back to normal. Phillips concluded that one of the ways in which people commit suicide is by deliberately crashing their car, and these people were just as susceptible to the contagious effect of a highly publicized suicide as were people killing themselves by more conventional means. The kind of contagion Phillips is talking about isn't something rational or even necessarily conscious. It's not like a persuasive argument. It's something much more subtle than that. When I waiting at traffic light and the light is red, sometimes I wonder whether I should cross and jaywalk, he said. Then somebody else does it, and so do I do, too. It's a kind of imitation. I'm getting permission to act from someone else who is engaging in a deviant act. Is there a conscious division? I can't tell. Maybe afterward, I could brood on the difference. But at the time, I don't know whether any of us knows how much of our decision is conscious and how much is unconscious. Human decisions are subtle and complicated and not very well understood. In the case of suicide, Phillips argued, the decision by someone famous to take his or her own life has the same effect. It gives other people, particularly those vulnerable to suggestion because of immaturity or mental illness, permission to engage in a deviant act as well. Suicide stories are a kind of natural advertisement for a particular response to your problem. Philip continues, you've got all these people who are unhappy and have difficulty making up their mind because they are they are depressed. They are living in this pain. There are a lot of stories advertising different kinds of response to that. It could be that Billy Graham has a crusade going to that weekend. That's a religious response. Or it could be that somebody is advertising an escapist movie. That's another response. Suicide stories offer another kind of alternative. Philip's permission giver are the fundamental equivalent of the salesman I talked about in chapter 2. Just as Tom Gow could, through the persuasive force of his personality, served as a tipping point in a word of mouse epidemic, the people who died in highly publicized suicide, whose deaths give others permission to die, serve as the tipping point in suicide epidemics. The fascinating thing about this permission giving, though, is how extraordinarily specific it is. In his study of moral fatality, Phillips found a clear pattern. Stories about suicide result in an increase of a single car crash where the victim was the driver. Stories about suicide murder result in an increase of multiple car crashes in which the victim include both drivers and passengers. Stories about young people committing suicide result in more traffic fatality involving young people. Stories about older people committing suicide result in more traffic fatalities involving older people. These patterns have been demonstrated on many occasions. News coverage of the number of suicide by self-immolation in England in the late 1970s, for example, prompted 82 suicide by self-immolation over the next year. The permission gives by an initial act of suicide, in other words, isn't a general invitation to the vulnerable. It's really a highly detailed set of instruction specific to certain people in certain situations who choose to die in certain ways. It's not a gesture. It's a speech. In another study, a group of researchers in England in the 1960s analyzed 135 people who had been admitted to central psychiatric hospital after attempting suicide. They found that the group was strongly linked socially, that many of them belonged to the same social circle. They conclude, this was not coincidence. It testified to the every essence of the what suicide is, a private language between number of common subculture. The author's conclusion is worth quoting in full. Many patients who attempt suicide are drawn from a section of the community in which self-aggression is generally recognized as a means of conveying a certain kind of information. Among this group, the act is viewed as comprehensible and consistent with the rest of the cultural pattern. If this is true, it follows that the individual whose particular situation, usually of distress, wishes to convey information about his difficulty to others, does not have to invent a communicational medium de novo. The individual within the attempted suicide subculture can perform the act which carries a performed meaning. All he is required to do is invoke it. The process is essentially similar to that whereby a person uses a word in a spoken language. This is what is going on in Micronesia. Omni at a much more profound level. If suicide in the West is a kind of crude language, In Micronesia, it has become an incredibly expressive form of communication, rich in meaning and nuance, and expressed by the most persuasive of permission givers. Livingstone writes of the strange pattern of suicide on the Micronesian island in Imbere, a community of about 6,000. Between 1955 and 1965, there wasn't a single case of suicide on the entire island. In May 1966, an 18-year-old boy hanged himself in his jail cell after being arrested for stealing a bicycle, but this case seemed to have little impact. Then in November of 1966 came the death of R. The charismatic Shion is one of the island's wealthiest families. R has been seeing two women and have paddled one child in each of them. Unable to make up his mind between them, he hanged himself in romantic despair. At his funeral, his two lovers, knowing of the existence of the other for the first time, painted on his grave. 3 days after R's death, there was another suicide, the 22-year-old male suffering from marital difficulty, bringing the suicide toll to two over the week. In a community that had seen one suicide in the previous 12 years, the island's medic wrote, "After Ali died, many boys dreamed about him and said that he was calling them to kill themselves. 25 more suicides followed over the next 12 years, mostly in clusters of 3 or 4 over the course of a few weeks. Several suicide victims and several who have recently attempted suicide reported having a vision in which a boat containing all the past victims circled the island with the deceased inviting the potential victim to join them." A visiting anthropologist wrote in 1975, "Over and over again, the theme outlined by R resurfaced. Here is the suicide note of M, a high school student that has one girlfriend at boarding school and one girlfriend on eBay. And when the first girlfriend returned home from school, two girlfriends at once. A complication defined in the youth subculture of eBay and grounds for taking one's own life. Best wishes to M and C, the two girlfriends. It's been nice to be with both of you." That's all he had to say, because the context of his act had already been created by R. In the eBay epidemic, R was the tipping person, the salesman, the one whose experience overwrote the experience of those who followed him. The power of his personality and the circumstance of his death combined to make the force of his example endure years beyond his death.